Hello and welcome to today's webinar, Act Like You Mean Business, sponsored by the Georgetown University Alumni Association and Alumni Career Services. Thank you for taking the time to join us today. My name is Emily White and I'm the Assistant Director of Alumni Career Services here at Georgetown, and our presenter today is Rob Biesenbach. Today's webinar has been very well received by our alumni community. We had over 270 registrants for today's webinar, and we're thrilled that so many of you are able to join us. Before we begin, I'd like to share a few housekeeping tips and reminders. Today's webinar is being recorded. You can access the replay of this webinar within 24 hours on our YouTube channel or website. There are two audio options. You can listen via your computer speakers or dial into the conference bridge number provided. Participants are not required to have a headset, but you're welcome to use one. It is important to note, if you experience audio difficulties while listening via your computer speakers, this can be caused by having multiple software applications open. Feel free to close some of these applications or simply join us using the conference bridge number provided in your reminder email. Questions are welcome. Please type in your questions in the question area on your GoToWebinar control panel screen. Rob is planning to answer as many questions as time will allow during the Q&A component of today's webinar. We'll email out a copy of the PowerPoint slides after today's session. If you're having any technical difficulties, please submit those concerns to me via the chat area if possible. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce our presenter today. Rob Biesenbach is a communications consultant, actor, and author of the book Act Like You Mean Business, Essential Communication Lessons from Stage and Screen. His 20-plus years in corporate communications and public relations include service as Vice President Ogilvy Public Relations Worldwide, Press Secretary to the Ohio Attorney General, and Communications Director at a Washington, D.C. association. As an actor, he has performed in more than 150 stage and commercial productions. He brings these two worlds together to help his corporate clients communicate more successfully. We're so thrilled to have Rob join us today, and I want to thank you, Rob, in advance for sharing your time and expertise, and I'm going to now turn it over to you.
All right. Thank you very much, Emily, and thank you to all of you. I am a former Washingtonian, spent 20 years there in Washington and its environs, so this time of year, I envy those of you who are still there, especially with the cherry blossoms out. It's a wonderful time of year. And thank you, Emily, for that introduction. It's true that I'm an actor, and I'm actually one of the very few people who can honestly say that I'm not a doctor, but I've played one on TV. And that's me in the middle. As you can see, they got my good side. It's a fantastic moment in acting. I want to start today by taking you back in time to the mid-1990s. It was a wonderful time to be in the workplace. For those who weren't around or are having such a good time you don't remember it, let me just set the scene. It was a time when the markets were up, unemployment was down, and the internet was barely a gleam in our eye, as evidenced by this actual business card of mine. You can check out that email address, so cumbersome it refuses to be contained on a single line. I think the percent sign is especially an interesting touch. It's a wonder we got anything done back then. But I was working at this place, which later became Ogilvy PR Worldwide, and this was an episode that I like to call A Tale of Two Presentations. Now, the first of these presentations was a disaster, but the second one was a success. And yet, you may be surprised to hear that these two presentations were essentially one and the same. How can that be? I'll tell you. One of our biggest clients was a major Midwestern manufacturing company. And like so many major Midwestern manufacturing companies of that era, it was not sharing in the wealth of the 90s. It was still experiencing tough times. It was being undercut by more nimble, lower-cost competitors. Its stock price was in the toilet, and the relationships between management and their largely unionized workforce was acrimonious, to say the least. And into this situation stepped a brand new CEO, hired from within the company but new to the CEO's office, and he vowed to turn the company's fortunes around. And we, as his communications team, were charged with helping him make the case to employees. One of the pillars of our efforts was a tactic that's commonly known today as the town hall meeting. And I'm not going to say that we invented this tactic. I'm just going to suggest it and move on before you have too much time to think about it. So there we were, down in Indiana, at this plant that made engines in a drab, windowless room, much like this one, and the CEO was talking to 25 or 30 UAW members, United Auto Workers. Tough crowd, obviously, although we had little idea of exactly how tough. Because the CEO got about 10 minutes into his presentation, and he was interrupted with kind of a tough question, which he answered, and then he moved on, and then he was interrupted again, and this time the question was a little more hostile. But he answered it and moved on, but then he was interrupted again and again and again. And each question got a little bit more aggressive, and the tension in the room started to increase until finally this very large, very angry man, artist's depiction here, rose up out of his chair and started yelling at the CEO, literally yelling. He said, "You are stupid. You're incompetent. You don't know what the hell you're doing. You and your team are driving this company into the ground. I don't believe you. I don't trust a word you say." And the guy stormed out of the room. And there was this sort of shocked silence. We, the staff, were in the back of the room doing the old collar tug, going, "Glee, there goes our case study." But the CEO, to his vast credit, managed to make his way through the rest of the presentation, and the people filed out, and then it was time to face the proverbial music. The CEO was not happy with the way things went, and he wanted to know what we were going to do about it, because in 20 minutes, we had another group coming through to hear the exact same thing. And this time, he was looking for a different result. So we stood around thinking about what to do. I was shell-shocked. I did not know an employee could yell at his CEO. This to me was my rough introduction to the world of organized labor, the great leveler. But as I thought about it, something occurred to me. The answer was actually right under our noses, literally. I said that this plant made engines, and right in the front of the room near the podium was this great big engine that they made right there in that factory. And I said to the CEO, in essence, never trust anybody who says they can recount a conversation verbatim from 15 years ago, but I said essentially, before you begin the next presentation, take a moment and talk about that engine. What does it mean to you? You've been with this company your whole career. You worked in this very plant. You helped design this engine. What's the brand mean to you? Why are you here today? What are you fighting for? And so the next group filed in, and as they settled down, the CEO paused a moment at the front. And he walked over to the engine, and he may have put his hand on it, I don't exactly recall, but he just started talking spontaneously and authentically about his early days in the plant, about some of the design challenges they faced. He got into the technical specs of the engine, which these guys ate up because they spend their lives making this thing. And he talked about his love for the brand and the company, and it's his hope for the future. And the atmosphere in the room turned around 180 degrees. It was an amazing moment. Now, I'm not saying that they hoisted him on their shoulders and invited him out to the union hall for beers, but they listened. They still asked tough questions, but they were respectful. And nobody got up and walked out of the room, which at that point was one of our key metrics of success. And I didn't realize it at the time, but what the CEO did that day, he was acting. He was putting on a performance, and not in a superficial, phony way that you might think of when you think of acting. He was embodying the very best characteristics of the very greatest performances. He connected with his audience on their level. They may have disliked him and distrusted management, but they loved those engines, and they loved the fact that he loved them too. He opened up and showed a personal side of himself that they never expected to see. He told a story about his early days in the plant and the challenges he faced. He used emotion and tapped into those common feelings that they shared about the company's products and its heritage and their love for the brand. He expressed himself visually using the engine as a prop, essentially, to create an indelible impression in their minds of what it was that connected them to each other. And as in any great drama, he raised the stakes. This was a company that was founded at the dawn of the Industrial Revolution, and he was going to be damned if it was going to go down on his watch. And as I said, it later occurred to me that this was a whole new way of looking at communications. See, I think the problem these days is too often in business, we look to others who are just like us for inspiration. We compare ourselves to our competitors and others in our industry. And the problem is, when we look for inspiration in all the same old places, what happens is everybody starts looking the same. And you're never going to stand out by trying to fit in. And I believe, instead of looking at other businesses, we should look at show business. After all, where are the most popular and compelling stories in our culture coming from? They're coming from movies, TV, and to an extent, live theater. We spend $10 billion a year going to the movies. The average American spends 35 hours a week watching TV. It's like a full-time job, and unfortunately, in this economy, for too many of us, it is their only job. And finally, live theater. I don't have a statistic for live theater. I just wrote Cats. It's a very popular show. You may have seen it. But live theater draws its own legions of passionate fans. Jerry Brown, the governor of California, has this rare distinction of having twice followed actors in the office. First, Ronald Reagan back in the 70s, and more recently, Arnold Schwarzenegger. And he had this to say. He said, a lot of this is theater. How do you communicate to 38 million people? It's gesture, symbol, the narrative, the drama. Who's the protagonist? Who's the antagonist? So others have made this point. They've drawn this connection between the world of performance and the world of business. But normally when they do, they talk about how you can use acting techniques to be a better speaker, to give better presentations. For me, it's much broader than that. I believe every communication should be treated like a performance. Every speech and every presentation, yes, but also every meeting, phone call, memo, email, networking event, job interview, blog post, status update, tweet, whatever it is. If you treat it like a performance, and if you adopt the proven techniques that actors use, you're going to be much more successful in that communication. So, this is our agenda for today, some of the key lessons from the book. And I believe we also have a polling question, Emily, if you want to jump in. Maybe we don't have a polling question. We'll just move on.
Oh, sorry. It's taking a minute to launch. I'm going to launch
it does.
Now.
Sorry
about that.
I should have given you more of a heads up.
No?
Okay.
All right, so the polling question is, what is your biggest communications challenge? And we're going to share the results instantly with the group in just a couple seconds. Is it delivering presentations, motivating employees, marketing your business, or networking marketing yourself? All right. So, Rob, the results are in. Interesting. 57% said networking and marketing themselves. 23% said motivating employees. 17% said marketing my business, and 3% said delivering presentations.
Okay. Well, that's great. So 50% marketing themselves, and very
57.
Few. 57%. Okay. Well, we have a few things on presentations in this as well, but we'll tilt more toward the marketing yourself. There's plenty of stuff in here. Emily did share with me just some basic data about the kinds of people who are on the call today. I think there's a lot that everyone will get out of this, whether you're, there are many people from large companies and organizations, people, lawyers, consultants, people in advertising and PR. So I think this will help you in a lot of different ways, including how to network yourself. So let's get right into the lessons here. The number one rule of show business is to know your audience. And whether you're talking to one person or 100 people, an audience is an audience. There's this concept in acting called the moment before, and it's described in this seminal text called Audition. And the author says, every scene you will ever act begins in the middle. This is true if you do a scene at the beginning of a play, or the middle of a play, or the end of the play. Something always precedes what you are doing. So what the actor does backstage before going on, he puts himself in the world of that play and in the mind of that character. So that way when he hits the stage, it's authentic and it's in context and the audience accepts him as a normal natural part of the story. And that's what we have to do anytime we enter into a room or a networking event or whatever it is. Because like it or not, we are an interruption. We're always coming in the middle of somebody else's day, and they're caught up in their own concerns. So I talk about 6 questions that you should answer. This will work before a job interview, before a networking event, before a sales call, before a presentation, whatever it is. Who are they? This is the obvious million-dollar question. But before you go on a job interview, obviously, or sales pitch, you should be looking up people on Google and LinkedIn and finding out as much as possible about them. Before you go to a networking event, you should look at the attendees list. Who's going to be there? Who do you know? Who do you want to know? What's your strategy for approaching them? What are you going to say? What do you want from them? It's all about being strategic and knowing who they are. What do they want? Time and again, I sit down with a client at the beginning of a program or just a tactic, and they say, okay, this is what we want to tell them. And I always back up and say, before we talk about what you want, I want to know what they want, because that's what you have to deliver on. And if you can't deliver on that, they're never going to listen. So think about what the people you approach want. If it's at a networking event, they might want help. They might want to know about a resource. They might want to know that you've got the solution to their problem. What do they know about you? We all have heard from time immemorial that messages take lots of impressions to get through. But we forget sometimes we have a blind spot when it comes to our own communications. We can't bear to think that people aren't hanging on our every word. I experienced this in writing the book. For more than a year, I was talking about the book on Facebook, on LinkedIn. I was emailing people, messaging them. And I was still surprised at how many of my close friends didn't really keep up with the day-to-day details like I thought that they would. I would have people say, oh, so how are the book sales going? And I would say, well, it's not out yet. Or worse, they would say, when's the book come out? And I would say, well, it was several months ago. I knew that that was not one sale. That was one sale I did not make. So it's important to step back and remember to give people a little context. We tend to take up a conversation where we last left off in our mind, but the person we're talking to has been in a whole other world this time during that period. So a little context is helpful. What do you have in common? We saw in the opening story about how it was the engine, the brand, the heritage that brought the CEO and his employees together. You can do this on a group level. What are the shared history and emotional touchstones that might bring you together with your audience? Or on an individual level. If you've done your research on the person you're seeking out, you may share a fondness for French film, or you may have similar family dynamic, or maybe you both dislike pizza. Can't imagine that possibility, but that would be a good conversation point to get into it. If you've done your research, you should know how to connect. Now, these last 2 questions, I wouldn't say are the most important, but they're often the most overlooked. Mood, hugely important, because this sets the tone of what you're communicating, because it's not just what you say, it's how you say it. Are they anxious, skeptical, impatient, frustrated, distrustful? Or are they energized, enthusiastic, unified, engaged? Knowing this will help you set the tone for your communication, and if it's tone deaf, you're never going to have a chance to get your point across. And the other thing is, what are their doubts and misperceptions? You have to know these and dispel them. So say the person you're targeting in a networking event, or you're going on a sales call or a job interview, maybe there's a certain bit of experience that you or your company don't have, or a capability you're lacking that you know that somebody else they're seeing does. You have to dispel that doubt whether they bring it up or not. You find a way to talk about how you can compensate for that perceived vulnerability. Now, a great example about doubts and perceptions is Apple. Apple obviously has been a long winning streak, but one of the few fumbles they've had was with the white iPhone. The white iPhone was supposed to come out almost 2 years ago with the original iPhone 4, the black one. And when time came, 2 summers ago, they weren't ready. And they pushed back the launch date for the white iPhone. And then that launch date approached, and they still weren't ready, and they pushed it back, and I think they pushed it back again. And they were the subject of widespread ridicule among the business and technology press and among Apple fans. And when, at long last, the white iPhone was ready, this was how they introduced it on the website. Finally, instead of avoiding the issue, they took on their critics directly. They addressed the concern that they knew was on everyone's mind. And most companies will say, if they've had a major error or mistake, they'll say, I don't want to dwell on the negative. Why bring it up? Everybody already knows about it. It's been on the internet, it's been in the papers. But if you ignore that, if you cover up with boilerplate or rosy scenarios, your audience is going to think you're out of touch. So when Apple's audience saw this, they say, okay, they get it, they understand they screwed up, and they're even willing to poke fun at themselves. Now let's move on and let's take a look at this fantastic product that I'm so eager for. It's just about, I think, respecting your audience's intelligence. And again, all of these questions directed at the audience. That's the key way to connect with them and be successful, is to take the time to really understand them and where they're coming from. Storytelling is the basis of all art forms, basically, and of all of our communication. And we are hardwired for stories from an early age. If you ever come out of the movies and you feel like you didn't like the movie but you're not sure why, chances are it failed in terms of story structure. Because, again, we've been raised on stories, from fables to TV to movies. We have a certain set of expectations for how a story should go. There should be a conflict and a resolution, an escalating conflict here in Act 1, 2, and 3, and that kind of thing. And when a movie defies that expectation, it leaves us unsettled. And in the hands of a master, like the people who did Memento, which went backwards, or like in Pulp Fiction, which the timeline just went everywhere, you can mess around with structure. They're good at it. They're pros. Most of us mere mortals should stick to structure. And here's the basic story structure. I've got a lot to say about this, a lot in the book. It's basically a character in pursuit of a goal in the face of some sort of challenge. And for today's purposes, I'm just going to focus on character, because that, to me, is the heart of the story. In the end, nobody cares about processes and programs. They care about people. And I'm betting every one of your companies or your clients' companies has wonderful characters and stories among your employees and customers and other audiences just waiting to be found and told. And I'll give you an example. I was working with a manufacturer of candy and gum. And if you have any experience in the food industry, you know that food safety and quality is a huge issue in that industry right now, with all the reports of tainted products, foodborne illness and such. So they wanted to demonstrate their commitment to quality. So we got a camera crew and we went around talking to employees. And I went down the line, I was talking to this one woman. She made gum. Her name was Estella. And I asked her, what does she do to ensure quality in her day-to-day job? And she walked me through her processes, and she showed me her checklist, which was this complex matrix of all these different qualities she looks for. And then she demonstrated this x-ray machine that checks for impurities. And it was all very factual, but it didn't grab me. So I knew she had kids, and without really knowing where the story would go, I just said, so your kids must think you've got a really cool job. And she lit up. She said, oh yeah, they love me, I'm the candy lady. And she turned over the package of gum, and on the bottom of the package was a code. And that code tells you exactly when and where the gum was made, right down to the individual production line and shift. It's for traceability purposes in the event that there is some kind of problem. And her kids can read the code. So what happens is, when they go to the store, the kids run to the candy aisle, they turn over the packages, they read the code, and they say, this is mommy's gum. My mommy made this gum. And it was an incredible story. Here is a company that you can count on for quality. It's good enough for your family because Estella is down there on the line every day making sure it's good enough for hers. And this is the kind of story with a great character at the center that will go much further than facts and data alone will ever do. Seth Godin is a marketing master. If you're at all interested in communications or persuasion or selling or psychology or people, anything, this is a good blog to read. Many of you probably are readers. It's short, sweet, elegant. But he said this. He said, the market is not seduced by logic. People are moved by stories and drama and hints and clues and discovery. Logic is a battering ram. Now, then, we just talked about some of the elements of what goes into a good story. Just as important to a good story are the things that you leave out, starting with exposition. I took classes for a number of years at Second City. One of them was a year and a half long program in sketch writing. And every week we would come in with a finished sketch, 5 to 7 pages, a comic sketch for our fellow classmates to critique. One day the instructor said, take the first 2 pages of the sketch in your hand, tear them off, and throw them away. Page 3, that's your new starting point. Start in the middle. And the reason he had us do that was that so many amateur writers, and sadly many professional ones who make very good living doing sitcoms, they load up their stories with needless exposition. And we want our stories to get straight to the action. And the corporate world is full of needless exposition. Companies love timelines and histories and situation analysis and status updates and all this other stuff. But if we start with a story, we're going to grab people's attention, like I did with this presentation. I think it's much more interesting to jump right into the story. And this can be done with everything, with videos. When we did that thing for the candy manufacturer, we put that story right up front. Case studies are so often written from 30,000 feet. They're impersonal, they're uninteresting, they have no drama, characters, or conflict. There's no reason you can't do a case study focusing on an individual who is having a specific problem that your company has solved. Websites, articles, everything. If you can get to the action, it's a much better way to go. And you can dispense with a lot of the unnecessary stuff. Another technique to shortening your stories is trim the details. I know we have a lot of lawyers on the line. I've worked with hundreds of lawyers in my time. I have great respect for them. But lawyers and technical types have a real affection for dates. And sometimes dates are necessary, but very often they're not. The case was decided March 7th, 2008 case. Nobody cares that it was decided March 7th in 2008. You can just call it the 2008 case. Or just the case. The only time you ever really have to use a date in your communication is if the date has real relevance to the story. My girlfriend broke up with me on February 14th. I was laid off from my job on December 25th. That's a date. Those are dates that are relevant. Same goes for numbers. Numbers don't have to be so precise. 35% is not an interesting number. More than a third, that gives it meaning. 52%, again, that's just a label. It doesn't really say what it is. More than half, we don't have to be so precise with the details. Some other thing, if you find yourself saying "and then" a lot in your stories, it may not be an actual story you have, but just a random sequence of events, which is fine if you're on the couch at the end of the day commiserating with a loved one over a glass of wine about all the things that happened to you. It's another thing if you're reporting to your board of directors or telling your boss what just happened at this conference. Try to give things, you know, some structure, some beginning, and the middle, and the end, and be careful about long sequences. I compare it to the trunk of a tree. When you're telling a story, verbally or written, you want to start at the base and go in a straight line up to the top. And any time spent out on the branches is dangerous territory, or God help us, the twigs, because you're starting to get into possible dead ends, places that you might lose your audience. So stick with the trunk of the tree. Practically everything that we write or say can benefit from being shorter. Videos, really, online videos should be 1 to 2 minutes. A video came over my RSS feed this morning, and I clicked on it, and and my heart sank because it was 3 minutes and 24 seconds, which doesn't sound like a lot, but really, we all do this. We have like 15 windows open on our computer, and somebody's got a 3.5 minute video, and I watched it for about a minute and 20 seconds, and I tuned out because it was too long. People have short attention spans. If you have a long video, break it up into its constituent parts, one topic per video. Try to get it down. Your emails should be one screen or less. Memos, a page or less. And if you're ever unsure where to cut, read your words aloud of whatever you're writing. And when you start to get bored, that's a good place to cut. Now, some of the best stories are not just told, they're shown. David Mamet, great American playwright, has written many things like Glengarry Glen Ross, The Untouchables. For a while, he was in charge of a show called The Unit. And he wrote this memo. As it says here, it was a master class. It was a memo to his writers. And you can look it up if you Google Mamet Memo The Unit. It's widely available. It has tons and tons of lessons for anyone who's interested in writing or in television and movies. It's insightful. It's funny. It's typically profane for Mamet, and it's in all caps. But one of the great pieces of advice he gives to his writers, he said, pretend your characters can't speak and write a silent movie. And we see this very often in the shows that I admire most, like Mad Men and The Dearly Departed Friday Night Lights and The Wire. These are shows that make great use of long silences and spare dialogue. So much goes on literally between the lines. And as an audience member, you're engaged in helping to figure out the story because it's not always spoon-fed to you. And again, in corporate America, we do so much spoon-feeding to people. Put another way, this is a great book. Again, it's a Bible for screenwriters, but it's widely used by anybody who's interested in communications. It's all about story structure. It's a bit of a dense tome, but there are great lessons in there. But Robert McKee said, image is our first choice, dialogue the regretful second choice. So both of these people are telling writers that words are just one way to communicate. What are some others? Well, there are at least five others that I can think of. And the first one is images. And obviously, you don't want to use just any old images. You don't want to use clip art. We see a lot of the same stock photography over and over. Going back to Seth Godin, he wrote a great little treatise. It's free. You can download it. You can Google it. It's called Really Bad PowerPoint, and it tells you what not to do. And I know a lot of people said that giving presentations was probably low on their list of challenges, but maybe even if you think you've got it nailed, you could learn a few lessons from him. One of the things he said was, talking about pollution in Houston, instead of giving me four bullet points of EPA data, why not read the stats, but show me a picture of a bunch of dead birds, some smog, and even a diseased lung. And you're welcome. Out of sensitivity for this lunch hour, I decided to go with the smog. But someday I'm going to get that dead bird in there and really surprise an audience. Steve Jobs, among his many legacies, was he was a master showman. If you watch his keynote speeches that he did twice a year, this what you saw were great big beautiful visuals, huge headlines, very few words, very limited text. And people, one person, Guy Kawasaki, who was a protege of his and later, you know, he has his own thing now, he said he's shocked by how many executives never learned this lesson from Steve Jobs. They looked to Apple for almost every other thing, from innovation to creativity to any other lesson. But in terms of presentations, people are still reading slides, using them as scripts, putting lots of dense text up there and not using pictures. So check out one of his presentations sometimes. Not all of us get to present on topics that are as exciting as the new iPad. It's a much different thing when you're explaining your new supply chain management strategy or your new benefit structure for employees, but this is something we can all strive for. And it's not just about presentations. I was doing a project for a big insurance company, a photo shoot, as an actor, And they dressed us up in these wacky costumes and gave us these weird props. That's me holding a duck, fake duck, obviously, in front of a bunch of rolls of duct tape. And I spoke to the creative director. I said, boy, this is a fun photo shoot, but I can't imagine what you could possibly be using these images for. And he said three interesting things. He said, first of all, we're trying to get away from cliches. The insurance industry is full of cliches, the person under the umbrella, or when they're talking about risk management or risk assessment, the person standing on the precipice of a cliff. The second thing he said, we're trying to be less literal with our images, more evocative. And the third thing he said was, we just want to grab people's attention. If they see a funny photo and it grabs them, maybe they'll tune in and actually read this sales copy that we have. This was used in their promotional materials. And you know, if you are doing presentations, there are a lot of great free resources for good quality images. Maybe your company has a stock photography site. You shouldn't be using Google Image. Most of that stuff is owned by other people. But I have a blog post on WordPress under Act Like You Mean Business called How to Find Free Beautiful Images for Your Presentation. So if you're ever looking, that's why I got all the images here. And if you're ever looking for creative, fun images like these, that will give you some guidelines. Four other ways, going back to our thing about show, don't tell. What can you replace words with? Video, obviously, has never been cheaper or easier to produce. Practically everybody has an HD-capable video device in their pocket on their phone. And I'll give you an example of this in a moment. Some of the best images are three-dimensional. Again, we saw how the prop could be used. Emotion is an important way to show instead of telling. I think we all understand innately that emotion is going to be more persuasive. Like I said earlier, logic is a battering ram. We saw that with the candy lady. Emotion really beats facts. And we can put this to use in other ways, at a networking event, in a job interview, in a new business pitch or a client pitch. Ricky Gervais, before he was a household name, had this concept for the show, The Office. And he went to the BBC with the idea. And this was recently reported in the New York Times. One of the BBC executives looked back and said, you know, it wasn't so much what Ricky Gervais said, but how he said it. He was so enthusiastic and so passionate about this idea. He believed so much in it himself that we couldn't help but believe in him too. It was contagious. And that's the kind of spirit we need to bring whenever we're trying to convince somebody of something, whether it's to buy our product or to hire us or to connect with us. Show some passion and emotion. Talk about what really fires you up. What makes you jump out of bed in the morning? What do you love about your job? What's the big picture? Or talk about your hobbies or your interests or your family. Whatever it is, find a way, because that will help you to stand out, especially in this marketplace where there are any number of people probably who can do the job you do. What's going to make you stand out is your individuality and your passion. And the final show, don't tell lesson, action. Action is the mother of all communications vehicles. People will not just watch what you say, but they'll watch what you do. That's why things like following up are so important. If you promise somebody something, to actually do it. You will actually blow people away in this day and age if you return a phone call, return an email, get them that thing you said you would get them. It's sad, but that's kind of the truth these days. You will stand out. The other aspect of this is show, don't tell is about more than replacing words with images and other things. It's also about how we use words. And we can use this again in networking, job interviews, websites. I like to talk about Match.com. If you've ever been on there, then you have my sympathies. But it's a funny thing. When you go from profile to profile, people describe themselves very literally and very much in the same way. They say, I'm funny, I'm intelligent, I'm adventurous. But here's an idea. Instead of saying you're funny, be funny. Instead of saying you're intelligent, talk about the last book you read. Instead of saying you're adventurous, show us a picture of the whitewater rafting trip you took. Show, don't tell. Now, the corporate equivalent of this is a company might say, we offer superior service, we offer highest quality, we offer the fastest turnaround. Again, don't just say it, show it. Show me your customer testimonials, your product reviews, industry rankings, news coverage, awards, accolades. Same thing with your resume, same thing when you're talking to people networking. Use stories, use examples, use third-party endorsements. If you're just saying, I'm this, that, and the other, well, that's fine, but we have the least reason of all sources to believe you, because you are the least objective about yourself. But if you've got somebody else saying something great about you, then that's the ticket. And I'll give you a real-world example beyond Match.com. I was working for this law firm, and they were a very different kind of law firm. They had this unique culture. They were a mid-sized firm, about 120 attorneys. And they had a culture that was fun, collaborative, collegial. People really liked each other, which was very different. People actually went on vacations with each other in their spare time. And they knew that this was a selling point to young attorneys who wanted to maybe get away from the large firm culture that might tend to be less open like that. So instead of doing what maybe every other firm would do and say, hey, everybody, we're a different kind of firm, they decided, or we decided, to show, don't tell. We came up with the idea of a contest, and we had their existing associates develop videos. We gave them some loose guidelines and a little bit of equipment and a budget and turned them loose. And they came up with funny, irreverent, wacky stuff, day in the life type stuff, commercial parodies. This is a parody of the old iPod commercial, hallway beanbag fights. It was great. And they got a lot of buzz on message boards and blogs, and people were talking about them saying, boy, this is a different kind of firm, which was exactly our goal. And we never had to say they were a different kind of firm again, because we showed. We didn't just tell. Now, before I conclude, there is a lot more in the book. We've just scratched the surface. There are many chapters on business writing and use of the language, and a whole section on my own grammar pet peeves, which I think everybody enjoys their own peeves. There's a whole section on editing, how to edit yourself, how to edit others without being, you know, kind of a jerk, and how to be edited gracefully. The importance of rehearsal. Communication should be planned. It should be strategic. Too often we go around life by the seat of our pants. How to use humor. It could be a dangerous thing or it could be a highly effective thing. I offer tips on that from the pros. And the art of listening, which is the whole basis of acting and of life. One of my favorite shows is The Simpsons, and you may remember this particular episode where Bart puts his red ball cap into the washing machine and all of Homer's white work shirts turn out pink. Total disaster. And Homer is mortified, but he has no choice but to trudge off to the nuclear power plant, where he's immediately spotted by Mr. Burns and Smithers. And Burns asks, who's that man in the pink shirt? Some sort of free-thinking anarchist? And Homer is then given a mental aptitude test and committed to an institution. And while this, of course, is parody, there are still some corners of corporate America where the nail that sticks up gets hammered down. And as a result, too often we live in fear. Fear of looking different, of standing out, of being laughed at. And I think this fear is at the heart of so much of the bland, ordinary communications we so often see. So if you need a little motivation, look to some unorthodox places. Think about the American Idol contestant who couldn't carry a tune if he was lip-syncing it. Does he care what people think about his voice? Or what about the aspiring author with the 5,000-page manuscript in her hard drive? Does she ever suffer from writer's block? Or what about that big guy in the locker room at the gym who insists on strutting around totally naked? Is he hung up on society's conventional standards of beauty or decorum? Absolutely not. So the thing that these people have in common is, to an extent, delusion. But we could all use a little more delusion in our lives if it means loosening up, taking a risk. Think of these people next time you're unsure whether to tell a joke or to do a wacky video or to participate in a company holiday skit. What is the risk, really? Martin DeMott was a beloved figure at Second City. He died in 2001, about a year before I started taking classes there, but his presence in the building and among the people there was absolutely indelible. Apparently, he was this one-of-a-kind, inspirational figure, flamboyant, funny, affectionate. He put everything in his work, and he encouraged his students to do the same. And he had this favorite saying. He said, "The hokey pokey. Think about it. At the end of the song, what do we learn? What is it all about? You put your whole self in." So take a tip from Martin. Attack your communications with passion and conviction. Hold nothing back. Be bold. Stand out. Tell a story. Paint a picture. Put your heart into it. Connect. Perform. Act. Thank you very much. And this is how you can connect with me, if you'd like, in various ways, on all of these various social media. And you know, if you're interested in this presentation and would like to see these lessons delivered live, I'm available to do that as well. Thank you very much, everyone. We'll take questions.
Thank you so much, Rob. We've gotten several questions coming in. I just want to remind folks that they can submit their questions through the question area of their GoToWebinar control panel page. Rob, one question we've received is, you've said that in communication, a performance is effective and achieve results. Would you recommend this strategy even for daily life, one-on-one communication with difficult people, and also including perhaps difficult family members or friends?
Yes. I've told people I am not a certified relationship counselor, but I do believe that many of these tactics can help you in your everyday interactions, especially with difficult people, because it's really about understanding your audience, what is motivating them, what's behind what they're saying, listening very hard to both what they're saying and maybe what they're intending, watching their body language, and taking very much care in the words you choose to use with them. So yeah, I do believe that can help you in those ways too.
Thank you. In your opinion, do you think it's safe or ethical to ask for the names of members of a search committee if the information is not volunteered in advance of the interview?
You know, I don't know. I mean, I will honestly say, unironically, that I am not an HR professional. I don't know what the regulations are having to do with that. In general, in life, I find it never hurts to ask anything. And maybe that's just being an actor. I'm used to being told no 14 times out of 15, so I'm kind of used to rejection. So I suppose it never hurts, but as far as the legal implications, you'd have to consult an expert on that.
Great response. Thank you. How do you deal with stage fright, Rob, if that's something perhaps you have to tackle?
Yeah, you know, the main time I ever get stage fright is when I'm feeling under-rehearsed, when I haven't prepared enough. So whether I'm in a show or anything else, the number one thing I do to combat stage fright is to just prepare. Just know your stuff, backwards and forward. Anticipate every possible question or objection and have answers in your mind. And just get your message down. It's one thing just to sort of sit there and practice in front of your computer or in front of a hard copy script, but when you're able to, like, talk, you give the core of your message as you're going about your daily business, grocery shopping, doing the dishes, just in your head, then that's when you've really started to internalize it. So I think that's the mental component, and I think that's most of the way there in terms of dealing with stage fright. There are some other physical things that I do before going on stage. I will stretch just like you might do before a workout to get the blood circulating, do vocal warm-ups, and breathing is critically important. Very often, if you go about your daily business, you might be surprised at how often you're actually holding your breath. And it's usually the times when you're concentrating or under the most stress. And that's when you need your breath the most, because it gets oxygen and blood to your brain. So before you go on, take several deep cleansing breaths, and that will help relax you.
Great advice. Thank you. Here's a specific question, perhaps maybe something you've had to deal with, though. If someone's asking you to address a misperception about yourself, or if you're trying to have the opportunity to correct misperceptions someone may have said about you, do you believe that you run the risk of reinforcing it by addressing it?
Yeah, you know, I have had that experience. And, you know, I always just, this is just a personal thing. I don't know what scientifically is most effective. I just know for my own peace of mind, I always feel much better if I've aired the issue. Because even if it backfires, if I have that like pressing on me, I just have to get it off my chest. And I will try to do it in a constructive way. But I have done that before. Well, I will call people out. If there is some kind of thing being said about me, I want to make it perfectly clear. And I've worked with many people who will find, who are very strategic, and they will approach a problem and they'll diagram it out about all the possible implications of doing that and come to the conclusion that that's not the right strategy. And if that's the way you're programmed, that's fine. I'm not like that. Maybe I'm a little bit of a bull in a china shop. But too often I think when you think about it that hard, the inevitable conclusion is just to not do it. I don't know if that helps. That's just my own personal perspective.
That's great. Thank you. Rob, when you have given live presentations either for in a, like a professional business setting or on stage or in general, and you're trying to get information across, do you think giving the attendees a copy of PowerPoint slides or notes to accompany it is a good idea, or do you think that could be distracting?
I would always just give it to them afterwards. I think especially if there's lots of words and they're going to be reading that and looking down, it's just natural human nature, and they're not going to be looking at what you're doing and listening to what you're saying. So now I would wait until afterwards to hand that kind of stuff out.
Okay, great. Thank you. Emotions can be a tricky thing. How do you find a proper balance with your work?
Yes, it is very tricky. Obviously, you don't want to be the office crazy person. You don't want to be flying off the handle. And you just want to kind of respect boundaries. So I think, yeah, it's going back to the principles. You're also appropriate. Try to read the languages, their facial expressions and body language to make sure you're not going overboard. But in general, I think our problem is too often we withhold too much. I think there's this thing in business that you have to be cold and solid and not be emotional. But we've all seen it when people give speeches or when a politician is up there and they have that emotional moment, it really makes an impact. You just don't want to, you don't want to overdo it. You want to cry at the drop of a hat, obviously. After a while, that starts to get ineffective. But judicious use of emotion can be very effective.
Great, thank you. Any specific advice or differences for communicating or presenting or performing for women versus men?
That's a very good question. Obviously, I hope it's obvious, I'm a man, and I was working with a CEO a couple of years ago. She wasn't a CEO, she was the manager of a manufacturing plant. And it's very unusual, and this was in a place and in an occupation where it was very unusual to have a woman as a plant manager. And I was advising her. She was having this issue of trying to get through to employees about what needed to change in the company. And I said, you know, you have to just sometimes pound the table and say, look, this is what I believe, and this is the way it's got to be. You know, show that passion. And she said, I can't do that. If I do that, that's going to reinforce everything that they already, every negative stereotype that they have about me or about women. It's like the Hillary Clinton syndrome, damned if you do, damned if you don't. So that's my experience. All I can say is, yes, it may indeed be different. And it's an unfair world. I don't have a whole lot of advice other than that, except it must be really, really hard to be in that situation.
Great response. Thank you. What if someone or the person they're working with or helping doesn't have a show business type personality or charisma to charm audiences with? How do you work through that?
Yeah, you know, I've worked, the CEO of that engine story at the beginning was sort of a natural performer. If people get to very high levels in the company and are not there, I've worked with some stiffs. And maybe you personally, if you're maybe you're more of a Mr. Spock than a Bones McCoy or a Jim Kirk. So I do have some suggestions in the book for how you can kind of tap into emotion. So if you're working with somebody or if you're just trying to do it yourself, there are questions to ask. And some of the questions I already talked about. What makes you jump out of the bed in the morning? What excites you about your work? Or what are your outside interests? And family is a big one. That's a big cultural, obviously, touchstone for people. So sometimes if you want to really get an executive to loosen up, ask him about his kids, if he has kids or she has kids. Ask them about what the kids think of what they do for a living. Ask them about the sacrifices they've made. And generally, that will help kind of prime the emotional pump.
Great, thank you. Related to the story you told about the CEO and the engine plant, how did he specifically diffuse the angry guy? What did he say? We have some specifics about that story you told.
Oh, the guy left. So there was really nothing to be done at that point. The guy left the room. I suppose we could have tracked him down, but I'm not sure how that would have helped. Ultimately, I hope what diffused that guy was hearing from the people who were in the second presentation and hearing about what a different experience they had with the CEO. And this is where a kind of a related point comes in, is word of mouth and the grapevine. You know, back before the internet, we always used to preach, we can give you all these tactics like town hall meetings and the fax machine and memos and speeches, but the one thing that is undeniable in its power is the grapevine. And now it's just amplified with social media. And so you have to recognize that, but you can also embrace that. Because probably later on, that guy probably heard from some of his fellow workers who he respects, who said, you know what, I found the guy pretty reasonable. And maybe that sort of changed his mind a little bit.
Great, thank you. Well, that unfortunately leads us to the end of today's Q&A. I want to share a comment we've received. We've gotten lots of great positive feedback, but this one in particular says to thank you and that you did a great job. You were very concise, engaging, and relaxing on perhaps the least relaxing topic for some of us. So thank you so much.
That's great to hear.
I also want to remind everyone the line will be sending a follow-up email shortly with a copy of the PowerPoint slides, details on how to access the archive recording, which will be available within 24 hours on our YouTube channel, and a follow-up survey, as we'd love to get your thoughts, and lastly, details on how to contact Rob and access his website. Rob, I'll turn it over to you if you want to close it out.
Yeah, well, I want to thank everybody. I put this last slide up. When you use photos, this is how you credit them. It's a nice thing to do for the people who provide these great images. And I just want to thank all of you. I hope you found it helpful. Thank you very much. Have a great day.